and welcome to another installment of Old Men Yell at Cloud. I'm Christopher, and I'm joined, as always, by Jim.
Hey, whoop whoop, where my juggalos at?
And Patrick.
I am also here without juggalos, yeah.
Cool. Tonight we're going to be discussing one of the best overlooked rock albums of the 90s, Hum's Downward is Heavenward. For this album, I could think of no one better to join us than Kyle Rasmussen.
Cool.
Kyle, how's it going?
Great.
Kyle is the drummer for a band called Phenomenal Sun, and if you've never heard them, I strongly recommend stopping the podcast for a couple minutes and giving them a listen, because they're pretty fucking
now,
good.
Now, is it Phenomenal Sun as in the, you know, the star, or is it Phenomenal Sun like, oh my god, yeah, that is a good boy? you are a good boy.
I do have to explain that every once
in
a while.
It's about Clint Howard. He is a phenomenal
Well, both
star.
Both are true. We're great kids, but... No, it's about that big thing in the sky that gives us all life and sustains everything for our existence.
The black hole, right?
It's also slowly killing us.
Yeah, but you know, aren't we all dying?
Yes.
From the day we're born?
I'm not.
I feel alive. It's about the sun.
Like Eddie Vedder?
I feel alive.
Not quite like Eddie Vedder.
Ooh.
But yeah.
I feel alive.
Yeah,
it's all true.
You guys have been kind of like gestating for a while before playing out too, because I remember, was it like 2017 that you showed me like the sketches?
Yeah, we started working on it, I guess, and it was actually fall of 2015, I want to say.
Oh, crazy.
Because it just started off with Addy and myself after we both left our previous bands. And yeah, we just started making demos, the two of us, because we were both writing stuff that didn't fit with either of the bands, and just set out with the intent of basically Steely Danning out a record as a duo. You know?
Calm down, you're going to give Patrick an erection.
Yes, we have a big Steely Dan fan here,
dude.
And it's not healthy, though. Don't encourage it.
I appreciate that. Thank you. It's triggering.
But yeah, we've gestating is a good way to put it, because we only started playing shows. We played our first show in January or February of 2018. So we'd spent all that time just kind of preparing and writing, producing, arranging, recording, and getting the band up to snuff, which has been a crazy experiment with pretty rad results, I gotta say.
Cool.
Yeah.
Very cool.
All right, so a little history about the album before we get off into this. Hum had just come off the road from nearly 2 years of touring behind their third album, You'd Prefer an Astronaut, in 1996, and were rushed by RCA Records back into the studio to presumably write another single as successful as their song Stars had been the year prior. The band attempted to record the new material with Keith Cleversley, but sensing that they weren't ready, they decided to wait a while longer before heading back into the studio to work on a new album. In late 1997, they recorded Downward is Heavenward with Champagne producer Mark Rubel at Pogo Studio. The material at this point was more fleshed out, and the band felt ready to be in the studio recording. Singer Matt Talbot hinted at some interband difficulties when interviewed. We've tried to put our creative and personal differences to the side, and we've dedicated ourselves to touring a lot and reintroducing ourselves to whatever fans we still have. I just want us to play as good of shows as we can for a year, and then see where we stand. Nothing is for sure as far as the future goes. He went on to describe the album's title. And this is just fucking wonderful. We're not much for meaning, hidden or otherwise, Matt confesses. It was the only title the four of us could agree on. Tim and I wanted to call it Big Badass Motherfucker, but had a little trouble selling that one.
That would have been so good.
It would have been very good.
Matt Talbot said that?
Yes. Yeah, no, there's some weird tripod site that's still in existence from like that era that was like a Hum fan site.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, so there's a pretty good article interview on there.
Big, fat, old, motherfucking chungus of an album.
There's a band from Providence called Bad Motherfucker.
I believe it.
They're angry.
Are they named after the wallet?
I don't know.
From Pulp Fiction? On the eve of the album's release, the aforementioned interview asked Matt what he would want people to remember after Hum is done. Is there anything he'd like for them to take away from the music? And he said, "That's a nice question. I listened to Dinosaur Jr.'s Bug yesterday, and it reminded me of lots of good times, but it's such a good record that I still enjoy it in a fresh way every time I listen to it. So maybe if someone else could have a similar experience with our music, I'd have to be pretty pleased." By the end of the year, the album had sold a then-unimpressive 30,000 copies. By comparison, their previous album had sold 250,000 in a similar time frame. They were provided little promotional support from RCA. They were eventually dropped from the label in 2000. Following a minor tour bus accident, the band called it quits at the end of the year. The band has reunited multiple times over the course of the years, notably doing a short tour with Failure in 2015. In late 2018, Hum announced a reissue of Downward is Heavenward on vinyl, which is what we listened to tonight, and confirmed that the band is working on new music. So, yeah.
Speaking of record sales, an interesting fact I heard the other day, actually, Ryan told me, the guest from Blast Tyrant. Did you know that as of 2010, Undertow has sold more records than Lateralis?
That makes sense.
Explain.
Lateralis came out in 2001. Undertow came out in 1993.
And it's better.
I will agree with you on that. It's not necessarily a popular opinion.
Right.
But no, it's just people bought albums when Undertow came out. People weren't buying albums when Lateralis came
out.
But Anima has sold more records than Undertow.
Yeah, people were buying records in 1996, too. You're not talking about an album that came out 2 years after Napster.
True. All right, another point.
Wrong.
So we were talking about album titles. So the previous album before this one was called You'd Prefer an Astronaut. He mentions that he doesn't really put like anything really behind the names, but I mean I want to know how that conversation was going. That came.
It's a line from a song.
Is
on
it?
The album, yeah.
Well, I mean,
you'd
I mean,
like your
was
hair
he like
long.
Drunk? So, was he drunk, like breaking up with his girlfriend? Yeah. Like, oh, I bet you'd prefer an astronaut. Well, like,
I think that's basically what "You'd Like Your Hair Long" is about, actually. Great song, though.
All right, so why don't we go around the horn and do the thing? All right, so we're gonna start out with best or favorite song, not best because that's fucking subjective. Jim, what is your favorite song?
My favorite song, and forgive me because I'm probably going to butcher this, Afternoon with the Axolotls.
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 I always thought it was Axolotls.
I'm saying that with confidence because I used to work at the Museum of Science, and I think that's how it's pronounced.
I'm saying that with confidence because I think
because
be
I'm
right.
A total bullshitter. Can we swear? Are we allowed to swear?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Right. Fuck yeah.
FCC isn't on us yet.
Yeah.
Now we're talking about Axolotls.
So I really dug how this one kind of starts off kind of sluggy and gross. And then it really fucking slams in.
Ah, oh, there it is.
Slams in. And there's this break. I don't know if it's the bridge or whatever the fuck. I couldn't really pinpoint what sections of what were in these songs. But it breaks in. There's like these little cosmic guitar little licks going on. I thought they were pretty cool. And I know, Kyle, you were kind of talking about how the guitarist kind of like layers things in so tastefully. And I feel like that was a good... good representation of that. What did you do at the Museum of Science? I love that place.
I was an audiovisual technician, and then I got promoted to coordinator. It was a two-person department essentially. So I set up all the. It was corporate AV at a nonprofit, but I did a lot of I did sound for a lot of really really fascinating lectures. They have a great lecture series. On all sorts of super relevant and like cutting edge topics, weddings, bar mitzvahs.
can you can get married by the giant Van de Graaff generator?
I've got friends.
I can get in there for free, and I always forget to go.
Why can you get in there for free?
So I
know of an entrance in the back.
No, so listen.
I know how you can get banned from there forever.
So when I worked at Microsoft, because Microsoft donated so much money to the Museum of Science, they let anybody with a Microsoft ID into the Museum of Science. Now, when I got laid off from Microsoft, they took my ID, my computer, everything, and I was like, ah, shit, now I can't do this shit for free anymore. 2 months later... I went to visit my old coworkers, and all of my shit was still sitting on my desk, so I took my badge back. Now I can get in the Museum of Science for free.
There you go. Cool. So when this episode is used as evidence in a court of law by Microsoft...
I'm not breaking any law. My badge isn't active. I just flash it at the Museum of Science guy, and they'll let me in.
Yeah, but what if someone tells on you to the Museum of Science?
Then I go, oh, I'm sorry.
The Museum of Science police is very, very lenient. I don't know how I got myself banned from there, to be honest.
How
I mean, they gave me so many chances.
Did you get yourself banned? I need to know this.
I didn't really.
Oh, you bullshit.
I'm a big old. I'm just having a goof on all y'all.
Patrick climbed inside the woodland animals exhibit and just like sat there and stared at everybody.
Yeah,
sniffing the beavers.
He was there for weeks before anyone found him.
I know that we're here to talk about an album, but I just want to keep talking about the Museum of Science for a minute. Yeah. I love that woodland animals section because it remains.
It smells.
It smells. Well, it's supposed to smell because you're supposed to be able to smell.
They
the
encourage
animals.
You to sniff.
Yeah, there's but musk.
What I love more than anything it's about that good. Wing of the Museum musk of Science button. Is it has remained unchanged since at least 1986.
Oh, 100%.
Yep. I fucking love it. Yep. And every time you go in, it's like, dude, this is like my kindergarten field trip.
Yeah.
All over again.
Yeah. My friend Jim Healy that we were just talking about before. Every time I'd see him when I was working there, is that space kips? Is the space capsule still there from like 1965?
Oh, yeah.
Like, yep, it's still there. It's so ragged. It's just I'm amazed that the fire department hasn't. You can't have kids playing in this thing anymore. It is so not OSHA approved.
Listen, you can't take this thing to space any longer. It's gone way too many times.
Stop selling tickets for that.
I remember I went there when I was really young, and they had like this talking robot. And it scared the ever-living shit out of me. And my brother was having a full-on conversation with it. And I was like, stop it! Stop talking to him!
No, Jim, Skynet is nice.
My favorite was the thing that like took a flash photo of you and put your shadow up on the wall.
Oh, yeah.
That was by far one of my
that's
faves.
Still there.
Yeah,
holy
shit. That's pretty dope.
That's amazing. Ironically enough, we recorded a bunch of tracks there after hours when I was still working there. I'd wheel my entire work desk up to one of the private suites. Where we were kind of secluded from everything else. There'd be like a wedding or something happening three stories below us, and we'd be blasting bass tracks out of a friggin', you know, PV Black Widow cab in one of the closets next to the Omni Theater. Yeah, it was a cool place to work. It was a really cool place to be after hours.
God, what was your favorite song?
On the record?
Yeah.
My favorite, man. It is a really, I don't know, dude.
We talked about this.
Yeah, I know, and I told you I was gonna have problems with it. I mean, I would say Afternoon with the Axolotls, but I don't want to copy Jim, and it is a toss up between that and the opening track, Isle of the Cheetah. Isle of the Cheetah to me is one of the best opening tracks. You ever do the high fidelity thing, best opening tracks of all time?
Yeah.
That is absolutely one of them.
I love the time
Isle of the
change.
Cheetah, what a fucking entrance that
I'd
is.
I'd say both of those tracks are a great example of what kind of just feels like very seismic guitar riffs.
Yeah, dude.
Just kind of like what it feels like you're kind of just drowning in everything.
That track is one of the most enormous introductions to a record. This record really tells a story, and that track just fucking nails it.
Yeah, and that was an interesting song for me too, because that song was the probably one of the few songs in Hum's career that kind of makes me feel like they're in the same ballpark as like really good Smashing Pumpkins.
Totally.
Like
totally.
I think that's the closest that their DNA gets to the Pumpkins' DNA.
And they're from kind of the same scene.
Same general
Chicago.
Area. Yeah. Yeah. Same neck of the woods. Cool. Patrick.
My favorite song is Miss Lazarus. Just think it's it's probably the most accessible on the record.
Did you say Mrs. Lazarus?
I said Miss Lazarus.
Okay. Listen,
if you're nasty,
she's not married. Okay,
I know. Hey, I'm respecting. Okay.
Do you see a ring on that finger?
Miss Lazarus is my father's name.
She's single.
it's a really nice arrangement. The way that they sort of bring the different parts in. There's a couple sections where it kind of slips into 3/4 time for a little bit.
Oh yeah, those acoustic bits.
Yeah, that's and it like slows down just a tiny bit to give it a little bit of drama. Mm-hmm. Like it's like one or two clicks down.
Yeah,
and then it's sort of and they come back into the B sections with like a heavier guitar, and just the way that kind of all comes together. It's his singing is probably like the most emotive and sincere to me on that song too. I feel like that kind of has the sort of sweetest pop melody to it in terms of like his vocal delivery on this particular record.
When you said sweetest vocal delivery, as soon as you started pronouncing that word, I thought you were going to go with Swedish for some reason. That was just sort of my assumption, and you didn't.
No, I didn't. And I'm gonna spare.
I'm just picturing.
I'm gonna
Swedish.
Spare the Swedish a really bad accent attempt.
All
right, cool. You beat me to it.
Imagine the Swedish chef singing that song.
Right, so now we've lost Sweden.
Yeah, now we pissed off Italy and Sweden.
No. We haven't pissed off Italy. We've pissed off Italian Americans, and that is different.
Okay.
Okay. So yeah, for me, I'm
which is scarier because they're closer.
Yeah, let them try.
They're
to do
a scourge.
Hey, man.
Do you remember the proclamation that I made on this show before about Italian Americans? They are cowards.
I've been listen to me. I've been watching The Sopranos. I don't want anything to fucking do with that, man.
Oh yeah,
that's all on you.
What's Tony Soprano gonna do to you?
He's gonna kick your ass.
Oh, is he?
James Gandolfini's dead.
Yes,
but Tony Soprano will never die.
I hear they're nice guys.
I think they're misunderstood.
I'm gonna be boring and also say Miss Lazarus. That's probably my favorite Hum song, and yeah, everything Patrick says and more. When it kicks in with that fuzz guitar and shit gets really off the hook later on, it's just it's a fucking nice little moment, and yeah, it's a fucking awesome rock song and one of the best I can think of from the 90s.
Woo!
Woo! Woo! Yeah, so we're in sync tonight. It's not one of those woo, nights woo, where we're making like completely opposite opinions and fucking...
You guys have
it's
been really pretty weird. In sync.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You guys have been really Justin Timberlake lately, let me tell you.
Oh, nice. Yeah. I get that joke.
Yeah. I'm a JC That's, Chavez.
I really like that you're right? able to just pull up 20-year-old cultural references and make a joke out of them.
Yeah. You cool. like that?
Yeah.
I'm gonna kill
all
you.
The hits from, all the hits from ninth grade.
what was your favorite song?
Fuck you.
Our least favorite song.
My least favorite song is going to be Green to Me.
That's a surprising pick. Explain yourself.
I don't know. It just felt kind of fucking...
Explain yourself at once.
It felt kind of emo pop punkish to me.
Yeah, fuck
so
you.
I fucking... I fucking love Green to Me, so don't get me wrong Same. On this. But...
Yeah, but you guys love all the songs.
No, but... No, hear me out. Hear me out. I'm going somewhere where you might want to follow. All right? So... I'm getting ready to go on a little journey.
Watch
so.
And
get
learn,
your nose
Jim.
To the ground and get ready to take a sniff.
A note that I have for this is something
Check out
the that
new
I've
Snell
always thought yeah. about this song. Basically, since it came out, maybe a little after, because for timing wise, it sounds like if Creed was good.
Oh my god, the that's a terrible analogy.
Yeah, and no, I can't. He's I, right. heard it, I heard it once and I can't unhear it. It's like, oh wow, if Creed was good, this is the kind of riff they would do. It's just that huge drop D.
If yeah. Creed didn't have yeah. Scott Stapp and wasn't religious and didn't have ties to nu metal and was a more artistically
look, man,
competent
I'm,
band,
you've
it
got
might
to squint.
Sound like this.
You've got
yeah,
to squint.
Kind of turn your head to the side a little bit. But that's not, a very interesting comparison.
My Own Prison came out 1998 as well.
Why are we talking about Creed?
No, okay, Scott so it's actually funny that you bring
question.
This up. Okay, okay. And I do have something to tie in here.
Oh, no, I'm all ears. I'm happy with where this is going right now.
Back in the day, back in like, it was really just like the late 90s, they started doing what advertisements.
If, what if? Oh, what if?
They used to do advertisements for CDs, like on TV. You guys remember that was a thing?
Yeah, Richmond, Virginia. They all came from there.
Yeah, they all came from Richmond, Virginia.
P.O. Box, whatever, Richmond, Virginia. Then and, the blue screen, send, yep. check our money order. Yeah, I remember.
There's one. There are three. There are exactly three that I remember.
Why did we ever accept checks? It's like, you can just fucking find checks anywhere.
It's a piece of paper that just says, I have this much money. Sure, I do.
It's a fucking note from mom. And like, you're handing it to someone as currency. It's so good. Anyway, sorry.
Anyway, so I remember exactly three of these commercials. The first of which was a commercial for Metallica's Reload, where it was like one bro telling another bro, like, whoa, what's that awesome new music coming from your room? It's Metallica's Reload. Whatever. The next one was one for Creed's My Own Prison, where they talk about how you know, insightful and fucking whatever. Yeah, bunch of bullshit. You know, hindsight is 2020. And then the third one was for Creed's Downward is Heavenward. Downward is Spiral Word. Downward is Heavenward, yeah. So it's funny that we all...
So what was that one? Do you remember what the context of that commercial was? Because you remember the other two.
That one, I just remember, like, a picture of the album cover and then, like, loud guitars. And I was, like, 14.
I bet you distinctly remember... being like, wow, this Creed song rules.
I mean, I did own my own prison at one point, so.
Yeah, to be fair, when Creed first came out, they weren't what they would become.
Oh, I know. Right? I
was unfortunately like the target. I was the target audience for fucking Creed.
I remember that one single that had, there was like one moment of one, I don't remember what song it was, but there was one riff that I was like, that's pretty badass. It's like, down, 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 down. It was like the one heavy part that I was, that piqued my interest.
Mark Tremonti will surprise you.
I think they had a few different angles on that first album. And they leaned into the wrong angle for the rest of their career.
They went with the worst ones.
Yes.
My parents blasted Creed a lot when I was growing up.
I'm sorry. No.
Kyle, what was your least favorite song?
Yeah. Again, this is a tough one because I literally fucking love everything about this record. But I guess my least favorite moment would have to be the intro to Dreamboat. That song does rule, but it has the most messy moments. That track has the most like fuzzy kind of, to me, unfocused sound, and I know they did that intentionally, but that's like the five bars of that record that kind of lose my interest for, you know, by like
there is something a little weird about there is something kind of weird about when that clean guitar riff comes in at the beginning.
Yeah, right.
Or right before the verses. It kind of gets awkward or just like it's not filling up enough space or something.
Yeah, it's that one moment where they, I mean, again, they totally do it intentionally because then they bust into that really cool chorus. And but it's my least favorite guitar riff on the record, I think.
Mm. Fair enough. Mm. Patrick. Mm.
So, really unpopular opinion, I don't like the last three tracks on this album.
You're an idiot.
I'm an idiot. I know, I'm an idiot. I like
this guy's got some sass.
I almost always get through Dreamboat and usually like shut it off around then.
In You a Promise, really?
Scientists?
Come on.
I think The Scientists is kind of a weird last track. It doesn't feel like it really finishes out the album.
We will
it
take
feels
care
like
of you. We will take take care of everything.
I don't listen to lyrics. I want like a
That's
big,
your problem right there.
See, I want an album to end with like a, you know,
can't listen
big,
home without
you know,
listening
C
lyrics.
Minor chord held down an organ or something like that and like explosions.
You sad man.
I'm very sad in that way.
See, I don't like the Inuit promise because we all know that
I just sort of like tickle you. Saying, come on.
We all know that Inuits can't keep promises. Come on.
Wow. we're gonna lose our Canadian fan base too, our Northern
Canadian. They're not
Canadian.
Canadian.
Oh, you're right. I'm sorry. But
them
I'm
and,
actually
going there.
We
Eskimo.
Just lost Canada now because you confuse them with Inuits
and Eskimos.
The Yukon,
so
okay.
Everything north of
the Eskimos, like we're not fucking Canadian.
Listen, I didn't invent colonialism.
Us while
all right,
we kill some whales.
Okay, so my least favorite song is actually going to be Apollo.
I'm thinking of a number between everything and two.
I think it's nice, but a little bit boring.
Cool. I am going to go with Dreamboat as well.
And you said that there was no upside down. I hit the star shift off at the parallax slip like you showed me in the lighthouse. I did the math and you came up ones and errors.
It's a fun song. It's not really hum enough for me, though. There's something that's distinctly not hum for a
silly
lot of
title.
Yeah, and I think the lyrics are kind of silly. And
like, is it supposed to be kind of tongue-in-cheek or something?
I think
what
it is.
What a shitty song.
Fuck you, Matt Talbot.
Jim drew a picture of you, and it is not flattering.
to be totally fair, yeah. That song does have one of my favorite endings.
Yeah, that, I mean, it's
when
it's,
they just slam those four open chords.
It's not without its merit, for sure.
That part is just epic.
Yeah, it's not without its merit. And
then they sail away in the whole, like, you know, stay.
And it is it is least favorite, too. So it's not it's not like I fucking want to, like,
that song
kill someone when
an
I hear the song.
8 out of 10. I'm jumping ahead.
Sorry. Jim, MVP moment.
My MVP moment is actually going to go back to something that Patrick was mentioning.
It's not a stable place to put that.
For his favorite song. The slight tempo change at the end of Miss Lazarus.
I only wish that it was mine.
Oh, yeah.
Going into the outro there, that is spectacular.
Yeah, it's done for. It's very subtle, but really makes a huge impact.
Yeah, it's not a huge BPM change, but it's like you hear it.
Hear it and you feel it. Yeah, for sure.
Cool, Kyle. MVP.
I felt it in my left foot. Oh wait, no, that's the gout.
Oh,
how's that going, by the way?
Still hurts.
Oh Jesus! Damn.
You've got gout, bro.
I think it's post gout now.
Post gout.
Not it's
that's a new, post rock genre of music.
I'm without gout.
Post gout.
I'm in a gout rock band.
I'm a no gout band.
What kind of post gout?
Yeah, basically
pre mono.
Woof.
Kyle, what's your MVP moment on this album?
My MVP moment has always been the 8 bars right after the first chorus of Green to Me.
It's a very heavy moment.
Yeah, and it's straight.
It's really emo.
It's one. It's well, it's there are a few stretches of this record that actually give you like 4 solid bars just to headbang.
Yeah,
and that's it. That's the first and finest moment. Just be like, yes, yes, yes.
They're a band that has no business chugga chugga wugging, but they. Damn, they are going to chugga-jigga-wugga for you.
They're going to do
it. Patrick, calm down. Jesus Christ.
It's more of a jigga-jigga-jugga moment, though.
All right.
Getting racial over there.
I'm looking at your illustration of Matt Talbot from here.
He looks like a sex offender.
That's what I was thinking. It looks like a really bad like police sketch.
Yeah, Matt Talbot just kind of looks like a guy.
Yeah, he does, and that's part of the beauty of this band.
You know what?
He looks and sounds like a guy.
When obviously I knew I was tasked with drawing this gentleman, and when I looked up his picture and seeing him for the first time, he reminded me of somebody who I'm not going to repeat on the air. We will talk post-show.
Matt Talbot looks like the anti-rock star.
Yeah, exactly.
It's not just that he looks normal. It's that he's got those big dumb glasses, and he, you know, I love you, Matt Talbot, but you're kind of a nerd. You're a total nerd.
You could be easily confused for the guitar tech.
They are the
Patrick, your MVP moment.
So playing around with some new terminology, was thinking maybe we could call this the kicking the toaster into the bathtub moment.
Dark.
Okay.
You know, it's the moment on the album that you want to die to.
It's the moment that makes you want to kill yourself the most.
Yeah, exactly. On that note.
You know, you finish a downward spiral, and then when Hurt's over, you just put the toaster in the...
I'm going downward, guys.
Sorry, that moment is actually the low C chord that hits the first entrance of the heavy guitars in Afternoon with the axolotls. Axolotls, sorry.
Axl Roses.
Axl Roses. Afternoon with the Axl Roses.
Oh, no. That's a decent band name, too, the Axl Roses.
Oh, Afternoon with the Axl Roses.
I just feel like that guy's pissed all the time at everything and anyone.
You gotta take him down to Del Taco because, like, he got a bad order yesterday and he needs to go back there to complain so he can get a free one today.
Sick. Write it down. We lost Axl.
Del Taco's great.
We've offended Axl now. That's an entire racist beat of humans just on its own.
We have angered one man. This is awful.
Anyway, I think it's an example of what the band does well, kind of summed up into one.
Wait, what were you talking about?
I was talking about the moment that low chord, heavy guitars come in at the beginning of that song, and it's just going to like, and like you just kind of get swallowed up in it. It's good shit.
Yeah, actually, in another example of us kind of being on par, that was going to be mine as well. Just that fucking, as soon as that distortion kicks in and those guitars kick in, that song fucking
huge lifts.
It is fucking wonderful.
Yeah.
But you know what? I'm actually going to go with, I'm going to go something slightly different. I'm going to go with the, just sort of like the little guitar trickery and what have you that was going on in the background of Green to me, especially around the bridge. There's a lot of really cool things happening with Queen guitars and just other melodies coming in, and everything kind of had its eight bars or such and then dropped out, and then some different tone would come in, do something different, and they were all like very hooky. It was all very, very cool.
Mm.
So that would be my Jim, what is your comparable album to this?
I had a few in mind, but I'm going to go with Dismemberment Plan's Emergency and I, an album that we have done before on the show. I kind of felt I brought this up when we listened to it. I was like, is this a DeSoto record? Because it kind of has a DeSoto vibe to it, I feel.
Well, yeah, Matt Talbot is definitely in with the DeSoto crew, so that
yeah.
Makes
I mean,
a lot
I was
sense.
I was gonna do that one, or I was gonna do Shiner, which are both DeSoto joints.
Yeah,
so.
And yeah, Shiner, it definitely makes a lot of sense to me. Yeah. Kyle, how about you?
In terms of mood, you know, like space rock. This is Downward as Heavenward is a space rock record through and through. It's all about, you know, a kind of detachment and floating around in literal space. Fantastic Planet by Failure is in a very similar vein. You know, not in terms of sound per se, just but intent, like artistic intent and like the mood that it puts you in. I find is a, you know, they're painting a similar picture. But arranging a different soundscape, you know, a different sound entirely, but puts me in the same kind of vibe.
Yeah.
Son of a bitch.
Ha ha.
I was gonna pick Fantastic Planet, and if I wasn't gonna go with that, I was gonna go with Dismemberment Plan's Change, though. I'm gonna go with that record.
Change, okay. Why Change over Emergency and I?
Because Change is like...
Because Jim said it first.
Well, because Change is like, it's a little less... it feels a little more like kind of emotive and cleaner and like less chaotic.
Yeah, it's definitely less spastic.
Less spastic and like, yeah, more kind of focusing on like these sort of intertwining guitar lines and shit. And there's, there's a definite kind of mood, like a nighttime mood to that record that you can kind of... This record for me is definitely kind of like a later in the day sort of record.
I gotta get into that. I've never listened to Dismemberment Plan. I was saying before.
Yeah, Emergency and I is the one to check out.
Yeah,
do that's actually
one. Do your homework, kids.
I mean, Change too.
I actually do play that album fairly frequently now that we did it on the show.
Just out of curiosity, what albums have you guys come back to? This is like completely apropos out of nothing, but like I bought the Beach House album when we were listening to it that night. Are there any others that you guys have like actually sought out after the fact?
Dismemberment Plan I did. I listened to that Stevie Wonder record we did a lot. There's a few. Yeah.
I got really into the Depeche Mode album that we did.
Songs of Faith and Devotion.
I put it on and I was like I could actually probably, I don't think we were rating records back then, but I would probably give it a higher letter grade nowadays.
I haven't given it I need to give it, because I do like some Depeche Mode, like here and there. I'm not that familiar with him.
It's a them.
Yeah, them? Okay.
All right, cool. Yeah, so that was just out of nowhere. My comparable album, Fantastic Planet, is certainly one for me. Circa 2004, I was listening to this album fucking nonstop. I was listening to Fantastic Planet nonstop. And I was listening to Spiderland nonstop. I'll probably go with Spiderland for me, because those three albums were fucking all I was listening to. Rick Surrett, who was a guest on the Spiderland episode.
Fuck that guy.
He's a real piece of shit. He and I were in a band.
Love
back
his memes.
Then.
Love him.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, he is the king. We were in a band at the time, and we were talking about like what we wanted to do musically, and like, what's Slinterpole? That's what we want to do. Slinterpole. And this was back when Interpol was cool, because like, they only had the first album in Antics, so like they're actually still a fucking cool
band.
Make
no mistake, they are not cool.
They're not. They're opening for Morrissey, so they're not even doing a tour, because you know it's going to get canceled.
Yeah, seriously.
But it was funny because we were friends with like other people who were in kind of bands of the same ilk.
I liked Our Love to Admire.
It was all right.
I just like to give Interpol a hard time. I don't know. People get all fucking uppity about them, and I don't know.
The first two albums are great, and then the rest of it's all right. but no, we were friends with other bands who were playing like similar kind of music, and one of them was like huge into Hum, one of the dudes in the other bands, and he's like, "You ever hear Dredge?"
And, oh no!
And I was like, "No." He's like, "Oh man, if you like Hum, you're gonna love Dredge." I did not love Dredge. I do not recommend listening to Dredge.
That's the thing about this record.
I forgot about
Hum,
Dredge.
Like,
holy fuck.
When I don't use Spotify all that often, but like, yeah, you know, when you turn on a streaming radio station, I want to discover more space rock. They always get it wrong, because all of the space rock...
I want
rock,
to discover more space
yeah,
rock.
Yeah, well, you know.
Cool. Here's Dredge. Also, you can fuck yourself while you're at it, because we obviously don't give a shit.
Right. But, you know, there's not a lot of bands that fall into the same kind of appeal as Hum, because they're a little bit emo, they're a little bit post-hardcore, they're a little bit space rock, and more than a little bit space.
They're a band
rock,
that influenced a lot of those genres.
I guess so.
But like they take pieces from Hum.
Yeah, yeah. There's a lot of bands that I feel they get recommended to me mm-hmm. based on the fact that I like Hum, and I never like the bands that are recommended because of that. And I'm not sure why that is.
What's the name of Talbot's other project? Centaur.
Centaur. Yeah.
What do you think about them?
Yeah. All right.
I think I listened to that
you
album
know,
once.
I love Tim Lash's side project, though.
What are they?
Glyphted.
Glyphted is a very good band.
Glyphted
name.
Is... You ever listen to him?
No, I never heard him.
Glyph, dude... And this is why I feel like Tim Lash is... Tim Lash is the secret assassin of Hum. Yeah, they both went on to do their their side project. Centaur, you know, is all Matt Talbot's prettiness, you know, and I feel like Matt Talbot brought most of the prettiness and you know, songwriting to that band. All of the wacky shit, all of the spaced out shreddery, that's all Tim Lash all the time. And his side his project after Hum was this thing called Glyphted, and it was I believe just a two piece, and it's the best. It is the best lo-fi shoegaze record that you have never heard. And I mean shoegaze in the literal sense that, like, it sounds disgusting, like My Bloody Valentine, just like a wall of chaos and borderline disorder, but it's like loop-based. It's just fucking nuts. I've never heard anything like it ever before. And when I discovered it, it kind of revealed to me, like, holy shit, dude, Tim Lash is a goddamn genius.
Is that Under and In?
So creative, yeah.
That's
Under
the
and
album.
In.
All right, cool. Yeah,
check it out sometime. It is ridiculous.
Imagine if that guy,
not
Tim Lash
an
from
easy
Glyphed,
listen.
Was in a band with Matt Talbot from... Oh, wait.
right?
Be so sick.
Speaking of side projects of random people, Brian McMahon from Slint did a one-off project. Well, I don't know if it's a one-off or whatever. They only have one record called The Four Carnation, and it is fucking awesome. Mm. It is picture like his sort of like mumbly Slint vocal delivery over like weird, complicated, clean guitars, and it's all just like really quiet and subdued.
Oh, that sounds really cool.
Yeah, it's a really fucking cool record. All right, cool. So we got one last thing to do here, and that is to rate this on a scale of 1 to 10. No, all integers, no decimal points. Jim, what would you give?
Zero. It's a piece of shit.
Like you.
Oh.
Asked and answered.
That's my mama. All right, no, actually, this is going to upset some people, but mainly Kyle. I'm going to give it a 6, but hear me out. I listened to this on the way up to the cave in Wakefield, and obviously we just listened to a vinyl. I feel like if I gave this record a few more spins, I could get a higher rating. I just don't think I've really extracted all the nuances out of it.
Why don't you come the fuck back later then?
I haven't pulled all the nuances.
No.
And I know that they're there. I could definitely hear that they're there, but I haven't extracted them yet.
So as I came into this a little blind because I got it years later. I got, like I said, in like 2004 when I was like heavily listening to it. And it was a weird nut to crack because at first I was like, there's not like a single...
Well, so the thing is when I was driving up here, I was listening to the album, and I was like, a lot of these songs, like they kind of blur together, they sound all the same, and then listening to it the second time around, I was like, all right, I'm getting it now, and like I'm saying, like, if I give it a few more listens, I feel like I could bump it up to a 7 or 8, but
yeah,
for right now, it's
no, I think that's totally reasonable.
A sixer.
Yeah.
Kyle, what are you giving it?
I mean, kind of what you were saying, like, yeah, it's not exactly a first listen record. Yeah, well, you're a total dick, first of all, but that's besides the point. I hated you the first time I saw you. But it is definitely a record that takes a couple listens, but it's a bloomer, you know, like.
If you are to bloom.
It's, if, hey.
Oh, is that the song title? Like, very cool.
I give it a 10. I think it's one of my favorite records of all time. I think it's a secretly very influential record. You know, a lot of great bands that we admire, mm-hmm, admit that this is a great record, the one that was a big influence on them. And to me, it's a record that tells a story. The whole arc of the record feels like you're reading a book. You know,
yeah,
a really, really, really good book that's like a tough read, but you know is incredible.
Yeah.
To me, that's that.
So it's like Dianetics.
I don't even know what that word means, so I should.
Oh, no, it was a joke. It was L. Ron Hubbard's book.
We unironically espouse Scientology on this program.
Oh, yeah, we're hardcore Scientologists. So
I was telling the story on Slack the other day. Like, when I got out of school, I was applying to all these studios, and one of them who actually said yes was this guy who... I won't name names, but his name's Jay Fernandes, and he does Saucer Sound.
I won't name names, so here he is.
He tried to, like, convert me to Scientology while I was working at his studio.
No way.
He was like, here, go into this office and read this Scientology packet. He's like, I'm not trying to convert you, but here, read this packet. And
down in Florida? Or
no,
was
this
so
was in this was in Massachusetts.
Holy shit. And, we had those around
Did you
here.
Kill him?
No, but he went up, so he gave me this packet, and he said, here, work through this packet.
He's dead now.
And so I flipped through like three, he left and like went and took a nap or something. I flipped through like three pages of it, and I went,
yeah, yes, the well-known Scientologist afternoon nap. They all have to do it at 2:30 p.m.
I was like, I'm not fucking doing this. And so I went into the studio and dicked around for like 30 minutes, and I went, fuck this, and I quit.
Too creepy.
But at one point, he was like talking to something, and he was like, oh, yeah, man, then the mothership's going to come, but I can't tell you about that. wink, wink. And I was like, this is fucking weird.
I love how Kyle, like, very confidently was like, well, did you kill him? Like, he's kind of indignant about it. I don't know.
we all know. I mean, when you see one in the wild, well, you're supposed to take care of them.
Did you put it in a police report? It was kind of like with that same sort of energy. Like you're kind of like talking down to him about it. Like you were, you know, like
I don't know.
His dad, who knew better.
I mean, that was weird too, but I mean, supposedly the studio was like established, but when I was in there, like there was hum coming out of the main speakers, and the live room was
a
square. Yeah, hum was just fucking blasting out, and you guys know how I feel about them. So,
well, yeah, we all know Matt Talbot is a Scientologist. He's like probably second only to Tom Cruise
he's
in terms
not.
Of
fuck it. I didn't realize that Beck was a Scientologist.
Oh yeah,
and hardcore.
And I guess he was like trying to. And Wayne Coyne from Flaming Lips was like, yeah, he was trying to like fucking convert us during the whole tour.
I don't see Beck as the type that would try to convert.
Wasn't he like born into a Scientologist
yeah,
family?
Yeah, he was. He's a second generation.
Yeah, he's like from California, so they, like a lot of them.
Yeah, his
Travolta,
dad
too. John
his
Travolta.
Dad is a big time string arranger, actually. David Campbell. Open up like any five CDs you have from the 90s, his name will be in two of them.
Yeah. I mean, you know, we have Catholics here in Boston. They have Scientologists in LA. Like they're just all over the fucking place.
Yeah.
Patrick, what is your rating for this album?
I'm going to give this 7 out of 10, and here's why. I recognize that it's like a pretty incredible album, influential, hits on a lot of unique points, but it is a challenging listen, and it's one that, for me, doesn't hit quite... I don't quite understand it as much as You Prefer an Astronaut, which I would probably give a 7.5. But we're not doing integers. But
no,
we're
have
not
to
talking
round
about
that to an 8.
I don't want to. I think there's a lot of like really cool moments. Definitely a lot of things that you can kind of take you know, kind of implement into a variety of different rock sounds and I think they kind of helped forge a lot of things, but there's a bit too lack. It's a bit lacking in focus with some of the melodic lines here and there, to the point where it's a bit distracting. And like, I kind of wish they like fleshed some of the ideas out a little bit more. And it is, yeah, it's very. It has a lot of challenging moments that I think maybe with more listens I'll kind of come to understand more. It's funny because the album length is printed on the fucking front of the album, and I didn't realize this, but I had it in my head that this album was a lot longer for some reason. I felt like there were more songs, and I think it's just because some of the album tracks, some of the tracks run like over 6 minutes, and I don't necessarily think they needed to go that long, but I don't know. I think they do. You know, still fill up a good amount of space. And yeah, I'll give it a 7. Good shit.
Yeah, so for me, I fucking love this album. It is one that I can listen to almost any time, at any mood. When I look at the albums that sort of define what made me musically and that I still listen to this day, I ask myself, like, is it at the same level as, like, a Kid A or something like that for me personally? Mm-hmm. And it's not quite there, but it's fucking very close, so I'm going to give it a 9. Mm. And that cumulatively gives us an 8.25. So
fair.
Definitely past the grade.
Pitchfork.
Yeah. What did Pitchfork give it?
I don't know.
They had to have given it a high rating. It's one of those ones that got, like, not right away, got a lot of credit or something, but it has a lot of good retrospective reviews.
Retrospectives.
I think we can all agree that it's not a poppy record at all. I mean, it makes perfect sense that there weren't any hits off this record. It's not that kind of record. It's a very cerebral listen, but it is one. I mean, again, I've listened to this record hundreds of times, and you know, yeah, I wonder if I had been asked that question upon a first listen, I probably would have given around a 7 or an 8 myself. But you know, after listening to it so many times and appreciating the production and you know learning all the nuances about it, that you know, you guys are gonna come back next year and be like, oh, it's a fucking 10, dude.
Can I tell you guys about a weird dream I had last night?
No. After I tell you that we gave this an 8.25, Pitchfork gave it an 8.3.
Wow. Hey,
that's too fucking weird, man.
It's 0.5 too fucking weird.
Yeah, tell me about your dream, Jim.
This is the segment of the show where we talk about Jim's Insanity.
Yeah.
Jim's Insanity section.
Jim's Therapy.
Emily was like,
what's bothering you, Jim?
Emily was getting ready to go to a bridal shower today, and I was like half asleep, and I was just smiling in my sleep, and I realized I had a dream. I was at a horse racing track, but it wasn't horses. It was midgets. And
that
I
is
was
so insensitive.
And I
that's not the word you use.
And I whatever. and I was rooting for one of them.
You were rooting for the tallest one.
No, the racer was named Geiger, and I was like going Geiger, go Geiger, go, go. And it was very strange.
Sorry, I'd be rooting for this the tallest one.
This is why you don't eat tacos before bed.
This got awkward.
Okay.
But the funniest part was, it's like none of them had any
idea.
What
was the point of this, Jim?
They had no idea where they were going, and then Geiger realized what he was supposed to be doing, and he fucking hauled ass for the finish line, and I was like, yeah.
Wait, did you say Geico?
Geiger. Oh, his name is Geiger.
Okay.
I don't know why, but he was.
Like H.R. Geiger.
All right.
Isn't that a guy?
Yeah, no, he did all the alien artwork, and he was apparently a fucking horrible asshole. All right, so. One last thing that I want to do before we do plugs here. It's a segment to the show that I've wanted to be doing for a little while. There's a website out there called Alternative Nation.
Here we go.
Man. Kyle, are you familiar with them?
Vaguely.
Basically, they will print the most sensationalist, clickbaity headlines you can imagine, and the substance of the articles, if it's related at all, is tangentially at best. So what I would like to do is read an Alternative Nation headline and allow you guys to guess what the actual meat of the story is. I've selected one that you could summarize in a single sentence, so you don't have to like try to like put together too many pieces or anything like that.
Now, are we going to shout out answers, or are we going around the table?
Why don't we go around the table? That'd be fun.
All right.
And I'll let you know who is closest. All right, so here's the headline. You ready? Rage Against the Machine icon reacts to sad Mick Jagger news.
Wait, Mick Jagger, like MC capital J-A-G-G-E-R?
Yes, the McDonald's food item.
Yeah,
it's the McJagger.
Repeat it one more time.
Rage Against the Machine icon reacts to sad McJagger news.
Brad Wilk went to a Rolling Stones concert like, I don't know, in fucking 10 years ago, and he had a good time.
Okay.
That's not sad at all.
It doesn't matter.
Yeah, it really doesn't.
Rage Against the Machine.
I want to go last.
Rage Against the Machine icon reacts to sad McJagger news.
Yes.
Or Mick Jagger, the gentleman from the Rolling Stone. Man, icon, that could really mean anything. Is this a band member or someone who was tangentially associated with the band? No, because they didn't have any like replacement
sad
members.
Mick Jagger news.
Sad. Mick Jagger recently had to cancel the Rolling Stones tour because he was he's having like heart issues.
He had mad cow disease.
You can't get literal about it. That gives way too much. Now I'm not my creativity.
I know
all
too much now.
Yeah, I know too much now.
So I'm gonna guess that it has nothing to do with that. it's Tim C.
So Kyle has to do a Tom Morello thing.
Yeah.
Or you could do Zach. And fuck, for the way that this asshole writes, you could probably say Chris Cornell too.
Well, that's what I was thinking. Like, he's an icon, but he's dead. Like, he can't react to anything. He's just bones.
I think Zach De La Rocca was probably just sad to hear that they were actually still touring.
Okay, that's valid. And What's Timmy C up to?
Tim C actually visited Mick Jagger at the hospital, and they
was sad there was no Coke left in the vending machine.
Well, no, they instead of turkey soup, they brought him vegetable soup in the hospital.
All right,
it's real sad. Yeah.
So Jim had the correct band member. It was Brad Vilk. Oh.
Vilk?
Yeah, it's pronounced Vilk.
Really?
The W, yeah.
Like, oh, really?
Like Volkswagen?
Yes. So, yes, it was Brad Vilk, and Patrick actually got pretty close when he started thinking really literal about it. But here's what happened.
Mr. Vilk.
Brad Vilk sent a touching message to the Rolling Stones frontman Mick Jagger before his surgery on Instagram.
Oh.
How touching.
I hope Mick Jagger has a successful surgery and recovery.
Well, that's like almost a legitimate article, though.
But no! How is that?
I don't know.
That's not sad Mick Jagger news.
I mean, it's not, but it's like, it's kind of, no, you're right. It's terrible writing. I know that. I know that. But like, Brett Buchanan.
This is by Brett, too. About 99% of the content up there is by Brett Buchanan. And if you're listening to this and you're curious about Alternative Nation, don't go there. Just let me be the only one who provides them with ad revenue, all right? Like, let's not make this, like, a profitable bump for them.
Is that a con to get Brett what is his face on the show?
Brett Buchanan? Yeah, Brett Buchanan. If you hear this and you want to come on the show, come on. We'll review Love Beach.
You are. Man, you can't take our line. Come on. You're like his only lifeline at this point, and you're like directly putting food into his mouth. I hope.
Yeah, the last time I saw him, I did the Here's the Airplane and put some like nuggets in there.
Ooh,
like a baby bird.
Yeah, I have to chew it a little bit first.
Yeah, spit it in his mouth.
His teeth aren't quite right.
That's my favorite episode of Beavis and Butthead. Where they find the bird that's dying and Beavis chews up the worms and spits them into the bird's mouth. And there's like this fucking like opera music playing in the background.
I love that he figured out that was like he was like correct in doing that.
That's how Chris feeds Mick Jagger.
No, Brett Buchanan of Alternative Nation. Oh, okay, I feed him directly.
Yeah.
Kyle, thanks for joining us. This has been very fucking fun.
This has been really fun.
What do you got going on? This episode's going to be out tomorrow.
Yeah, it's very rare that a guest tells me to go fuck myself, so congratulations.
Again, too. this is going up super quick, so if you have anything coming up around the corner, feel free to plug it. Like, what do you got going on?
Nothing.
Okay, cool. Moving on.
I'm kidding. No, is it shameless plug time?
Yeah, yeah.
This is where I feel really weird. Yeah, I'm playing.
Get out of here. This is the only reason you came on the show.
Phenomenal Sun's playing the Rock and Roll Rumble. We played on Friday night, and we took the night. We're moving on to semifinals. We're playing at Once Ballroom Friday the 19th, next Friday, with Set Fire, Lonely Lisa and the Lost Cowboys, and Corner Soul.
I thought you were going to say Corn.
Corn.
Yeah.
Oh, they're back.
Or Soul.
Hashtag Corn is playing the Rumble.
Corner Soul is the wild card, so I think I'm right.
They break up and reform like in like fucking Alston or something. Yeah.
Collective Soul shows up by mistake.
Ooh. You guys weren't invited.
Do you know who I am? My name is Ed Roland, and I'm the singer of Collective Soul. I'm getting on that stage if I want. Jim, do you have anything going on?
Should I break the news that we're playing our first Rampike show?
Yeah, sure.
May 10th, right?
May 10th. That is the night. Yeah, and that's going to be at the Plow and Stars. Where Patrick, Jim, and I have a project together.
And John Sasser.
And John Sasser is going to be playing with us, too.
He's our touring musician.
Yes, he's
from
our touring musician.
From the Rush Counterparts episode. Counterpoints? Counterparts.
Counterparts. Yeah, the one with the thing on the front.
Yeah, the dick.
The rabbit. And the...
That's going to be at the Plow and Stars. And that's actually going to be for John Green's birthday. Which will be fun.
Cool.
Yeah, we'll be playing with his band, Fifth Business, and I don't know who else is on the bill yet, but that's going to be a really fucking fun thing.
We're going to have a nice smorgasbord of some Ease Into the Noise songs, some Smell songs, some Difference Engine.
Some Scratch and Sniff songs.
Oh, yeah.
Should we actually like finish a Rampike song and play it?
Maybe. We should definitely figure that out right now while we're recording, though. Yeah. That's very important.
All right, let me grab a guitar real quick. Hold on, we'll flush it out this next part.
Patrick, you got anything else?
Yeah, I mean, I'll plug the new Smell album. It's out on Spotify now. Spotify, iTunes, and the rest. It's called Viva Lasagna. Check it out. Check out, you know, some of the older albums, too. I'm going to be in that show.
And we're you're making a new Smell album. I've been tracking drums.
Oh, that's right. Yeah, Jim and I are working on yet another one.
Jim got the stems.
He finally got those stems. I don't know if we announced it on the show.
We did. He passed the torch.
Yeah.
He did. Material on that record is stuff that I've been working on, I think, since like 2015, 2016. So it'll be pretty exciting to get some of that shit out. And
I was pretty excited because Patrick had me play drums on some previous work, and I was very excited about the content. And then he took it away from me, but now he's giving it back. So.
Hell yeah, baby.
That was good of him. All right, cool. Yeah, no, I don't have anything else to really talk about.
And it's also, today's also the Boston Marathon. I still don't care if you're running it.
Fair enough.
Hey, how about that Game of Thrones episode, huh?
Well, yeah. Dragons. I love the... I love the wizard lady. I hope she wins.
They should have made everyone participating in the marathon to dress up like a White Walker.
Oh, that would have been pretty... Actually, that'd be terrifying. Just seeing them all.
Guys, don't do it. There's going to be a fucking like zombie marathon or some dumb shit in a few years.
Probably. So
no, I think Eric Marks, former guest of the show for Boards of Canada, I think he's done a zombie 5K
or something. Oh, yeah, sure
yeah,
he has.
Todd has done that, too, as well. Todd Bowes, another former guest of the show. All right, cool. That'll do it for us here tonight. Thanks for joining us, and feel free to hit us up at Twitter on Twitter at Yell at Cloud. We're oldmenyelletcloud@gmail.com. Shoot us some hate mail if we have offended you tonight.
We most certainly offended somebody.
Somebody listening out there, I kind of hope we offended you. I mean, just because...
Come on the show.
Just because I don't know you and I don't care. If I knew you, it would bother me that I offended you. But because I don't, I just don't give a shit.
I've been interacting you for exactly 8 seconds and you owe me.
All right, so that'll do it.
Till next time.
Till next time. Thanks again. I'm Christopher.
I'm Jim.
I'm Patrick.
And, we'll see you now. But the panel captures all of you. And 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 the panel captures all of you.
Lils and Patrick are two local musicians from the New England area whose minimal accomplishments have left them thoroughly unqualified to judge bands and artists who have been more successful than they ever could be. And yet, their passion for bad music persists on Jukebox Zeros, the podcast that takes a retrospective look at the worst albums of all time. From The Shags to Attila, from Cyberpunk to Scream, if there's a band that has an album they're ashamed of, Lils and Patrick will be there. Share their love on Jukebox Zeros, now on the Zero Science Network, and wherever podcasts may be found.